all to worship.
And good morning, 4th Street family. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. And one thing I want to say, this is Christmas coming up, joy, peace, love, generosity. But as a Christian, we know that's a lifestyle, not something we do once a month or once a year. So I just hope and pray we carry this spirit throughout all of 2021, because this world, during the pandemic, we need to have the light of Christ shining in our heart so they can have hope. And if you have a program from a previous service, we'll be reciting Article Faith number 7, Regeneration. And if you don't have a program but you're viewing from a device, you can read along with us by viewing from your device. We'll read in unison on the count of three. 1, 2, 3. We believe that the scripture teach that in order to be saved, the sinner must be regenerated or born again. That regeneration consists in giving a holy disposition to the mind that is in effect in a manner above our comprehension by the power of the Holy Spirit in connection with divine truth, so as to secure our voluntary obedience to the gospel, and its proper evidence appears in the holy fruits of repentance and faith and newness of life. Amen.
The church covenant, and it reads, having been led, as we believe, by the Spirit of God, to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, we do now in the presence of God, angels in this assembly, most solemnly and joyfully enter this covenant with one another as one body in Christ. We engage therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit, to walk together in Christian love, to strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinance, disciplines, and doctrines, to contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the expenses of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel through all nations. We also engage to maintain family and secret devotion, to the religion to educate our children, to seek the salvation of our kindreds and acquaintances, to walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in our dealing, faithful in our engagement, and exemplary in our deportment, to avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger, to abstain from the sale and the use of intoxicated drinks of a beverage, and to be zealous in our effort to advance the kingdom of our Savior. We further engage to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy and feelings and courtesy and speech, to be slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation, and be mindful of the rules of our Savior to secure it without delay. We moreover engage that when we remove from this place, we will as soon as possible unite with some other church where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word. And now to him who born again from the dead, our Lord Jesus, be the power and glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We're so thankful, God, that your Son Jesus is the light of the world. He was the light, is, and always will be the light of this world. Amen. The world that you made, and now it has become so corrupted, dark, dismal, mean, and hateful.
Yeah.
But Lord, your Son Jesus permeates this darkness, and he calls unto us to be examples of him, that we too may be lights of the world.
Amen.
We thank you, God, for this day, a day that we have never seen nor will see again. And we thank you, our Heavenly Father, for allowing us to assemble as we are in the sanctuary of the 4th Street Missionary Baptist Church.
Amen.
Whose pastor soon will break unto us the bread of life.
Mm-hmm.
We pray for him as he is empowered and powered by the Holy Spirit. We ask now, as we share together in this worship, that you would be with us. Bless every segment that will be pleasing in your sight. Forgive us of the sins that we have committed in omission and commission.
Yes.
And Lord, be pleased now with our offering of ourselves, our time, and our treasure to you. It is in the name of our Son Jesus, who died that we might live. Thank God. Amen. You may be seated. Please focus your attention on the screen for this morning's announcements and greetings.
Good morning, 4th Street. Today is Sunday, December the 13th, and these are your announcements. We are requesting Christmas gift donations. Please donate 2 labeled boy or girl pre-wrapped gifts and bring them all to the church office by December the 16th. Contact the music ministry to sign up as a volunteer. For more information, please contact Sister Angelique Riggins. The Singles Ministry will have a Christmas fellowship on Friday, December the 18th at 7 p.m. via Zoom. There will be games, an ugly sweater contest, and Christmas caroling. The meeting ID will be 816-4703-3868, and the passcode is 257-399. The Christmas toy drive will take place on Saturday, December the 19th at 10 o'clock a.m. The first 50 cars will receive a gift for every child present. It will be held in the church parking lot. For more information, please contact Sister Angelique Riggins. Happy birthday to all of our members born in December. Congratulations to all new parents and grandparents. And congratulations to Brother Jeremy McCrary, who is a featured muralist with Midtown Columbus. His permanent art mural is located at Zoe's Pediatrics. Boy Scout Troop number 69 is having a fundraiser for Camp Spirit cards for $10 each. Also, they are doing their recharter and registration between now and December the 15th. Their fee will be $33 per boy. Please contact Deacon Moore or the church office. Voters, please request your ballots for the Georgia Senate runoff election. Early voting begins December the 14th at the City Service Center. And the actual election day will take place January the 5th. Please continue to join us for Sunday worship via live stream on 4thstreet.org, Facebook, and YouTube for both worship services, on the radio Fox 105 at 8 o'clock a.m. and on television WRBL Channel 3 at 8:30 a.m. Please continue to join us for weekly Bible study via Zoom and Facebook Live. Deep sea fishing on Sundays at 5 p.m., spiritual brunch on Mondays at 11 a.m., and engaging asking on Wednesdays at 6 p.m., except for the fourth Wednesday. The following church school classes are available at 9:30 a.m. via Zoom: the Christian Family Class, Training for Service and Discipleship, the Intermediate Class, the Men and Women's Class, the Women's Class, the Men's Class, the young adult class, and the primary class. The youth ministry presents virtual children's class at 6 to 7 p.m. Every first and third Mondays for youth advisors to tell Bible stories, and the second and fourth Mondays are physical fitness with youth officers. Please contact Sister Sharonda Porter for more information. Sympathy is extended to Brother Kenneth Crooks and family for the passing of his wife, Sister Mary Gardner Walker Crooks. Also to Brother Jesse Stanley and family for the passing of his brother, Charlie Stanley. Please take note of the upcoming events. On Friday, December the 18th, the Singles Ministry will have a fellowship at 7 p.m. on Zoom. On Saturday, December the 19th, we'll have our Christmas toy drive at 10 a.m. in the church parking lot. On Sunday, December the 20th, we will have our Christmas recitations at 9:30 a.m. On Monday, December the 21st through the 26th, the church will have a period of rest. On Friday, December the 25th, we will have Christmas Day worship at 7:45 a.m. On Saturday, December the 26th, there will be Real Talk with Men at 8 o'clock a.m. And on Thursday, December the 31st, we will have Watch Night Worship Experience at 9 o'clock p.m. Stay connected with us via Facebook, YouTube, our mobile app, and our website. Please remember our tithing alternatives. You can mail your checks to P.O. Box 1591, Columbus, Georgia 31901. You can use the Finance Drop Box located inside the Educational Building, or you can access us via Giblify. Please take a moment to review the prayer list and pray for everyone on it. If you are interested in invitation to discipleship, please contact the church office at 706-324-2055, or you can email us at fsadmin@bellsouth.net and forstreetmbc@gmail.com. At this time, we'd like to welcome all of our guests who are visiting with us today. We hope that you enjoy the service, and please come again. The church office will be open Monday through Fridays, 10 a.m. until 4 p.m., and on Saturdays, 9 a.m. until 1 p.m. Please have your weekly announcements emailed to fsadmin@bellsouth.net or forstreetmbc@gmail.com by 4 o'clock p.m. on Wednesdays. Thanks for your attention, and have a blessed week.
Givlify is giving simplified. Givlify is the simplest, most beautiful way to give and track donations to the place of worship or charity of your choice. You're not limited to the cash you have on hand. There's no need to write checks, and there are no complicated forms to fill out or text message codes to remember. Givlify automatically pinpoints your location and intelligently identifies the fundraiser, worship service, or conference you're attending without the need to search. Since Givlify automatically detects where you are, making a donation can be completed in as few as 3 taps. Tap 1, use one of the pre-configured denominations to choose your donation amount. Tap 2, select the campaign to which you'd like to contribute. Tap 3, with your stored credit or debit card, complete your donation in one tap and get an immediate donation receipt. Setting up recurring giving is a simple 2-tap process. Tap the frequency you'd like, and you'll never forget to make your gift. Givlify lets you easily see your complete donation history. Mark the place of worship you normally attend as your home for quick one-tap access. Givlify. Tap. Give. Done.
I'm sure that each of you have seen the announcements and perhaps have taken note. Our pastor will officially thank those of you who were here on yesterday, and we are grateful for those of you who took part. We also want to emphasize the participation in deep sea fishing at 5 on Sundays and at 11 Monday brunch, then on Wednesday, engage in asking and with the youth directors on Monday, at 6. And then on Fridays, First Fridays, the pulpit helpers with the pastor. So we want to stay engaged. The pastor is working hard to stay engaged with us on Fridays around about 6:30. We always get the church-wide call from him. And so we want to pray for him, for our First Lady, that they will be empowered to do what they do and do it well for the benefit of God through 4th Street Missionary Baptist Church. Amen? Amen. Here's our pastor. Amen.
Let me say thank you to Reverend Dickerson and Brother Perter for being available to be our worship leaders. And we are very grateful to you in the streaming live audience, Facebook live audience, and the remnant that are present here today. Let me just ask that you will keep all the announcements in mind. Please place reminders in your most frequently visited location, whether it's in your phone device, whether it's in your iPads, calendars, however you remind yourself to stay connected and to stay engaged. I do want to thank the Department of Public Health for coming in yesterday in our parking lot and providing COVID-19 testing. And we want to thank those in our community who took advantage of the benefit of having free tests provided. So we want to thank them so very much for collaborating and partnering with us on yesterday. And I want to thank our deacons and our safety team for being available to help with managing the flow of the traffic coming in. I also want to just congratulate Brother Jeremy McCrary, a tremendous artist within our city, within our state, and becoming more and more known as it relates to his work, his artwork. And you can find it on a building at the corner of 2nd Avenue and 13th. And there's a mural that he's painted of African-American boys on the building. And so we want to commend him, want to congratulate him for the work that he has done there. And so we are very, very proud of him. Let me also encourage you to bring gifts. You can bring them up until Saturday, the 19th. The music ministry is sponsoring collaborating with the ushers ministry and the young adult ministry. To provide gifts. We are looking at, as we go into 2021, how can we really actualize the theme of this church, a caring, sharing, fruit-bearing fellowship. And this is an effort because of the unprecedented times that we're in this pandemic, where we would do a community Christmas meal, but due to this virus, we're asking that we have a community gift giveaway. And so we're inviting communities, we're inviting those who may not be able to provide gifts, that it is not the gift that the focus is on, it is the sharing, it is the generosity, it is to demonstrate the generosity and the caring that Jesus Christ himself brought into the world. And so that is what we're really wanting to actualize. And I want to thank those who have already brought gifts wrapped. We thank you so very much. And we are anticipating that we will continue to have members. And if you're a guest, you're more than welcome to also bring gifts throughout the week to be a part of this actualizing a caring, sharing, fruit-bearing fellowship. So if you don't wrap very well, don't worry about it. Just wrap it. We have various ages that we need gifts for, and if you rap very well, God bless you too. It will be deeply appreciated. We're going to ask that you would call Angelique Riggins or Irene Wilson, or you can call the front office and get age groups that's needed. But we just say, please bring a gift. I do want to encourage you to tune in on the third Sunday at 3 o'clock. The third Sunday at 3 o'clock. Again, we're living in unprecedented times. This would usually be our Christmas cantata that would feature, we believe, one of the best choirs on this side of the Jordan, the Forest Street Missionary Baptist Church Music Ministry. And so because of the pandemic, we want to thank our musicians for getting together. And there will be a Christmas musical that will be virtually streamed, and we're asking that you will get that information and connect with us, engage with us, as we continue to celebrate through our music ministry the coming of Christ. So these are the announcements and just emphasis that I wanted to make, and I want to encourage parents. We had a wonderful virtual class discussions on all levels, teenagers and also adults, and the family class, and so I was able to participate. But I want to ask parents, if you would please encourage your children while they're in this pandemic. I've been made aware that our children are struggling, whether they talk about it or not. They've had to have tremendous adjustments. They had to have tremendous flexibility to deal with this pandemic. And I want parents to encourage their children while they're moving through this pandemic to be anchored in studying the Word of God that will help them relieve that anxiety, to relieve the uncertainty. We had one, the teenage class that I was blessed to participate in virtually, and for the teenagers to talk about trust in God was refreshing. But you've got teenagers, high schoolers, and one of the things that they shared, the difference between those who may be unsaved and those who are saved as it relates to trust, is that those who are unsaved depend upon their sight, they depend upon their smell, they depend upon their touch to validate trust. But the difference for us as believers, we walk by faith and not by sight, leaning and depending upon the Lord. And to hear young people say that, to grasp that, was encouraging. So I'm going to ask parents, please encourage the youth, our young adults. We're going to encourage our young adults as well. So I just want to just share that with you to connect through our spiritual transformational classes. Dear gracious Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the worship. We thank you for these who have gathered here as the remnant to ensure that we continue to use the platforms that we can corporately and collectively still worship through live stream and Facebook Live, connecting us, even though we may be physical distance, but we're not socially isolated. So we thank you. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for watching over us all night last night and allowing us to have another day that we can say thank you. Thank you for family. Thank you for friends. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the food on our table, the clothes on our backs. We just want to say thank you even for salvation that you've provided, Lord, making it possible for us to be reconciled back unto God, to have salvation, to have eternal life. We thank you. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for our church, which is really your church, that you've allowed us to participate in by calling us out of the darkness into the marvelous light. Thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to participate in your church. Now, Lord, we ask that you would bless those under the sound of my voice. Bless those that are in hospitals and nursing homes and ICUs and CCUs. Bless those in the streaming live congregation, the audience, the Facebook Live audience congregation. Bless our guests, our friends. Bless in your own special way, for you know exactly what each and every one of us is in need of. So provide according to our needs, according to your riches and glory. Bless those who've had loved ones transition and they're walking through the grieving process. Help them to be reminded that there's hope during these holidays. Our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. Help us to know the object of our hope is Jesus. Bless, Lord, this world. Bless this nation. Bless this state. Bless our community, our neighborhood. Bless churches all across this land. Bless pastors all across this land. And we will stand on the unadulterated gospel of Jesus the Christ during these trying and difficult times. Bless marriages. Bless relationships, that they will be in your order. Bless now. Bless the message that will go forward, that it does not fall on stony ground, does not fall among thorns and thistles, but it will penetrate someone's mind, that will change someone's paradigm, shift someone's paradigm, shift someone's belief. We pray that they will come to believe in Jesus the Christ as their Savior and Lord. Send us who you want us to have and what we need, even during this time of virtual worship. You still can save. You have all power in your hand. Convict, convert, and compel one to come to believe in Jesus Christ. This is your servant's prayer. It's in the precious and glorious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. We want to ask that you would open your hearts and your mind. We have Sister Tresca Hardy, who's going to bless us with song accompanied by the musicians. And after which, we ask that you would open your minds and your hearts to receive the word of the Lord.
Did you know that your baby walked where angels trod. When you kissed your little baby, you kissed the face of God. Oh Mary, did you know the blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again, the lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is the Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? That sleeping child you're holding is the great I
am. Mary, did you know? What a profound question. That the baby boy that you will conceive would be the great I am, God in flesh, Emmanuel, Jesus, Yahweh saves. And so we're thankful to Sister Hardy for reminding us through psalm and through the musical instruments to remember during the season that the Immaculate Virgin birth by way of the Holy Spirit was God stepping into history himself to bring salvation, to make a way for us to be reconciled back unto God. So we celebrate the birth of the great I am, Jesus the Christ. I want to ask if you would join with me in a passage of scripture today. We had started on last Sunday saying we want to do a series of sermons by challenging our paradigm, challenging our belief system, to provoke us to think deeper spiritually, to challenge us to audit where we are in terms of our trust and our relationship with God through Jesus Christ during this time of the year as well as beyond. And so I said I want to do a series of sermons on what is the object of your, and last Sunday was what is the object of your hope. And so I want to go to a passage of scripture where we find in Exodus 15 that the nation of Israel has been delivered and liberated from the bondage of the Egyptians. They are now have crossed the Red Sea to the other side. And we find that God, through his power, has drowned Pharaoh's army in the Red Sea. And so we want to pick up the response of Moses and Miriam and the others to the deliverance of the children of Israel as they arrive on the other side of the Red Sea. Many biblical scholars entitled this chapter passage as the Song of Moses. I want to start with verse 2, which will also serve as our text verse, sermon text verse, but I want to read verses 2 through 4 as we hear Moses leading in worship and praise after God had delivered them through the Red Sea. Let us hear what Moses penned under the power and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. This is my God, and I will praise him, my father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The name, the Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his host he cast into the sea. And his chosen officers were sunk in the Red Sea. Amen. The Lord is my strength and my song. And I want to use as a sermon title, I want to tag this text, what is the object of your strength? In the streaming live congregation, in the Facebook live congregation, guests, friends, what is the object of your strength? When we say the word strength, immediately, possibly, many of us thinks of diet plans, workout routines, and trips to the gym. The word reminds us of the workout clothes we bought last year. With good intentions, noble, but never wore them. And I don't know about you, but mine may be a little bit too small about right now. To be physically strong and fit is a noble and fine goal. It's encouraged. But there, my brothers and sisters, is a greater strength that is even more essential. The Bible offers many valuable object lessons on discovering strength when you feel tired, weary, and worn, and overwhelmed, frustrated. God wants his word, my brothers and sisters, to comfort us in hard times and encourage our faith when we feel overwhelmed, frustrated, depressed, despondent, discouraged, despaired. However, please understand, Satan's goal is to make us feel weak, worthless, helpless, useless, and ultimately his goal is to destroy us. We, who are the we you reference here? Those of us who declare that Jesus Christ is the Lord of our life. We sometimes, many times, buy into, get hoodwinked and bamboozled by the lies that we are somehow not strong in Christ. We give in to feelings that can, many of us, never experience God's strength. Come close, streaming live congregation, come close, Facebook Live, come close, the remnant that gathers here. If this is you, then beware. God wants you to be clear about the object of your strength. So I come this morning to ask you the $3 million question. In the midst of this pandemic, I come to ask you the $3 million question. In the midst of death, I come to raise the $3 million question. In the midst of secularism, humanism, pluralism, relativism, sin, pain, depression, discouragement, and despair, I come to raise the $3 million question to you. What is the object of your strength? Romans chapter 15 verse 4 tells us, for everything that was written in the past, that was written in old times, that was written before, it was to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and in the encouragement they provide, that we might have hope. So my brothers and sisters, what can we learn from the scriptures? Not from Dr. Phil, not from Oprah, not from Life Magazine, not from Google, not from Facebook Live. No. What can we learn from the scriptures, old and new, regarding what is the object of one's strength? So I want to ask you to come with me as we ask the question. What was the object of the Old Testament chosen people of God's strength? There is a lesson to be learned. Lesson number one, the Lord is my strength. Moses declared in Exodus, our sermon text verse in Exodus 15 verse 2, the Lord is my strength and my song. Moses' strength, my brothers and sisters, consisted in the power that God, don't miss this, alone could supply. It was the Lord who had given Moses and the people deliverance from their Egyptian pursuers, from Pharaoh. Moses' words reflect more than this. For God's strength was the source of Moses' personal salvation. Because of his relation to the Lord, Moses could have strong courage and full confidence, not in himself, but confidence to be able
to accomplish his divinely appointed task that lay ahead, because it was promised that the children of Israel would be led to a land of milk and honey, the promised land. Moses had observed the source of his strength in the midst of Egyptians, in the midst of Pharaoh's 600 chariots that was on a seek and destroy mission, in the midst of the Israelite people, God's chosen, that he had just delivered from the bondage of slavery, and yet they complain about Moses. Amen. It was in God's strength that he would be able to lead them. Moses had confident faith that God would also lead his people into the land of promise. He had confidence in God, not in himself. It was in God who would empower him, that would give him what he needed to face the challenges, face the difficulties. The object of Moses' strength was clear. It was God. But there's another example that we can find, Reverend Dickerson, in the Old Testament that we can learn from. If I had to call one to the witness stand, it would be David. David was an outstanding example of one who had come to rely totally upon God's strength for his daily task and all his needs. I don't know if you remember what David wrote in Psalm 18, verses 1 through 2, but just in case you are having some temporary amnesia, maybe lapse of remembrance, I just want to remind us what David wrote under the guidance of the Holy Spirit in Psalm 18, verses 1 through 2. Listen, David said, David declared, "I love you, Lord, my source of strength. The Lord is my high ridge, my stronghold, my deliverer. My God is my rocky summit where I take shelter. My shield, the horn that saves me, and my refuge." The object of David's strength was God. It wasn't the three rocks, stones that he pulled from the brook as he was going to face Goliath. It was not the slingshot. It was God. David was clear. Who helped him slay the bear and the lion? It was not David, although David did it, but David recognized if it had not been for the Lord on his side. Is there anybody in the house? It's clear. The object of David's strength, my brothers and sisters, was God. And I just come by to ask the question to you today. What is the object of your strength? And I know we've been bombarded with humanism. I know we've been bombarded with secularism. I know we've been bombarded with New Age philosophy, theology. Find your best self. Tap into your best self. Call that into existence as though it were. Object of David, Moses' strength was God. What was the object of the New Testament believer's strength? Here's lesson number two. As we continue to peruse, as we continue to call and look at Scripture to learn. Lesson number two, the object of the New Testament believer's strength was Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. If I could just call someone to the witness stand around about here from the New Testament, I would just go ahead and call Paul. The Apostle Paul could testify that he commonly experienced times of suffering for which he was in himself insufficient to bear. He recognized that he could not endure this on his own. Yet he welcomed all that happened, even those trials, even the tribulations. Paul had a personal infirmity. We don't know what it was. We don't know what was going on in terms of the infirmity. Some biblical scholars believe it may have been an eye problem. Some Reverend Dickinson believed that it was when he referred to beasts, there were those in Ephesus that wanted to kill him, stalk him, stone him. But despite his pleas, take this thorn away from me, God. God was strengthening him to bear by faith the thorn. Because you do know what God's reply was to him. No. 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 He faced many kinds of attacks. Paul did in his ministry for Christ. Through it all, Paul could remember that the Lord had assured him. What did the Lord assure Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter number 12? He says, my grace, my power, my strength is sufficient, is enough for you. For my strength, my power is made perfect in weakness. And oh, my brothers and sisters, I know a lot of men don't like to acknowledge their weakness. But we've got a lot of 21st century strong women who don't want to acknowledge their weakness either. But he said to Paul, it's in your weakness, my strength, my power is made perfect. Because the strength he possessed had its source in Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And he could go on to face any difficulty or hardship. And I pray that you all don't miss that this morning in the live stream congregation, the live stream Facebook Live audience, or the remnant that's sitting here, because there's a lot of people want to face it all by themselves. David never would have faced Goliath by himself, even though the king tried to give him his armor. David said, the same God that was with me when I slew the lion. The same God that was with me that when I slew the bear. That same God will be with me when I will face the giant. Is there anybody in this house? And I just come by to tell you, Paul's testimony would be the same one that protected me when I was shipwrecked. Come on, somebody. The same one who delivered me from those who wanted to stone me. And he just went on in the epistle to the Philippians to declare that it is not his power that he lives out his life and ministry, but solely in the Lord's strength. Listen to what he says. He testified, I have experienced times of need and times of abundance. King James translation says, I've learned how to be abound. I've learned how to be abased. Is there anybody in this house? In any In every circumstance, I've learned the secret of contentment, whether I go satisfied or hungry, have plenty or nothing. My contentment is not based on having or the absence of. I am able to do all things through the one, through Christ, who strengthens me. I know you all know Philippians 4:13. I know you know Philippians 12:13. I know you know that, but the question is, do you believe it? Here's, I just want to leave you with a comfort point right here. This powerful presence enabled Paul to go through bad times and good times. And I know during this pandemic, I know so many of us who declare that we are believers in God through Jesus Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, we've had some ups. Is there anybody in this house? And we've had some downs. We are going through some ups and we're going through some downs. We're going through uncertainty. We're going through some uncharted waters. But I just come by to tell you, those of us who declare that Jesus Christ is the Lord of our life and we've been empowered by the Holy Spirit, we're not walking alone. The object of Paul's strength, he declares, is Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. Paul no longer relied on his own strength, y'all. Don't miss that. It doesn't matter how young you are. It doesn't matter how vital you are. It doesn't matter how much energy you have. It doesn't matter. Paul came to realize that the object of his strength was not himself. It doesn't matter how intelligent you are. God bless you that you have all the education. Go get more. It doesn't matter how much money you have. Paul realized that the object of his strength was not himself. Not his own strength. But the object of his strength was in Jesus the Christ, who lived in and worked through him by way of the Holy Spirit. I don't know about you, but I shout every time that the Holy Spirit brings that to remembrance, because I realize that there are some good days. There are some hills to climb. There are some weary days. There are some sleepless nights. But when I look around, and I begin to reflect, I begin to meditate, I begin to think things over, I've had some good days. Bad days, but I won't. The songwriter says, I won't. I will not complain. Paul clearly believed the object of his strength was in Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. So, my brothers and sisters, the lesson from the Old Testament, we see through Moses, we see through David, that they realized the object of their strength was God, the Lord. And we come over to the New Testament, and Paul is saying the same thing. The object of my strength, the Lord Jesus, the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. My brothers and sisters, I just raise a question to you again. So what is the object of your faith, your strength? What is it? Here's lesson number three that we have to really begin to pray the Holy Spirit illumine our minds and enlighten our hearts. The object of your strength as believers in Jesus Christ is the glorious might of God in Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. I know it sounds repetitive, but it don't change. There's a thematic continuance that's revealed here, that's connected here. The true object of your strength you received from the glorious might of God through Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, is so much more, my brothers and sisters, than money. So much more than better health. So much more than getting married. So much more than a feeling of happiness or a life of success. Instead, the object of your strength is in Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, which produces in you the strength to live in the will, the way, and by the word of God. I don't know if I can just rewind that and just press it forward one more time. Instead, the object of your strength is in Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, which produces in you, in every believer in Jesus the Christ, the strength to live in the will, the way, by the word of God. Oh, my brothers and sisters, Jesus' will for you is not some roadmap that tells you where to live, who to marry, and what job or career to pursue. Instead, Jesus' desire for your life is that you be saved, rescued from the penalty and the power of sin, and one of these old days to be rescued from the presence of sin. Jesus' desire for your life is that you commit to follow him as his disciple, that the whole world will know you belong to him. Jesus' desire for your life is that you become spiritually matured, striving for spiritual maturity, not staying immature, not staying, always being frustrated about the least and the less little thing, petty stuff. But Jesus' desire is that you spiritually mature and grow in holiness, to desire to live holy, to desire to live right, to desire to please God through Jesus the Christ. Enabled by the Holy Spirit is the desire to please him so that you will glorify God in everything you do. That's why we ask, why do you do what you do? It's for the love of God through Jesus the Christ. Jesus' desire for you is to serve him by serving others. Jesus said, I came to serve, a servant leader, not to be served, but to serve. It should be our desire to be just like Christ. Amen. He says, how can you say you love God, which you've never seen, you've never touched, you've never smelt? How can you say you love him and you hate your brothers and your sisters? You can't get along with your nieces and your nephews, your sisters and your brothers. How can you say you love him? The measure of your love for God is how you treat one another. Amen. And you can't do that in your own strength. You must, my brothers and sisters, know the object of your strength is God through Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit, in order to live in the victory of Jesus the Christ. So I just come by this morning to just remind us, to challenge us, to provoke us, to really examine, to audit truly, what is the object of our strength? Moses declared in Old Testament Holy Writ The object of his strength was God. David declared in the Old Dispensation, Old Testament scriptures, the object of his strength was the Lord. Paul declared in New Testament scriptures, the object of his strength was in Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I just come by to ask you the question, as I get ready to go to my seat, what is the object of your strength? You in the Facebook Live congregation, you in the streaming live congregation, what is the object of your strength as we walk through this pandemic? In the midst of 280,000 deaths, unemployment through the roof, what is the object of your strength? In the midst of loved ones dying, can you say without reservation, can you say without hesitation that you truly and sincerely believe the object of your strength is in the one who came down through 40 and two generations? Can you truly and sincerely say the object of your strength is in the one who was conceived in the womb of a virgin called Mary by the Holy Spirit? Can you truly say sincerely and earnestly, the object of your strength is in the one who walked the dusty streets of Palestine, giving sight to the blind, making lame men and women walk? Can you truly say the object of your strength is the one who went to a hill called Calvary, laid his hands down on an old rugged cross, allowed them to put nails in his hands, allow them to put nails in his feet? Can you truly say without a hesitation or reservation, the object of your strength is in the one who said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men, women, boys, and girls. I'll draw black, white, red. I will draw Asians, Latino. I will draw Mexicans. I will draw all men unto me. He is the object of your strength. Can you say, is in the one they lifted high, stretched him wide, put a crown of thorns on his head, blood streaming down his face? Can you truly say the object of your strength is in the one who cried out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do? Can you say truly the object of your strength is in the one who died between the sixth to the ninth hour? He took on the wrath of God. He took on the condemnation of God. He took on the judgment of God. He took your place. He took my place. Can you truly say the object of your strength is in the one who cried out, Tetelestai, it's finished. I'm not finished, but the work that my Father sent me on, the mission my Father sent me to complete, it's finished. Is there anybody in this house? You can't add nothing to it. You sure can't take nothing away from it. It's finished. Can you truly say the object of your strength is in the one who locked his head in his shoulder and gave up the ghost? Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus went to Pilate, requested his dead body. Can you truly say the object of your strength is in the one that the centurion soldier standing at the base of the cross said, surely this must be, this gotta be the Son of God? Can you truly testify that the object of your strength is in the one that they put in a bar of new tombs and he stayed there all Friday night? Can you truly say the object of your strength is in the one who stayed there all night Friday night, stayed there all day Saturday, stayed there all night Saturday night? Can you truly say, don't fool me all, can you truly say the object of your strength is in the one early, early, early Sunday morning, pull the sting from death, pull the victory from the grave, roll it up in his divine hands, placed it in the vault of eternity? Can you truly say that the object of your strength is in the one? Early, God raised it from the dead with all power, resurrection power, reconciliation power, saving power, forgiving power. Can you truly say the object of your strength is in the one who walked around for 40 days showing himself to his disciples, showing himself to 500 or more, proving that God's promise is absolutely true? You can rely on his truth. God's power, God's strength is absolutely real. Can you say that the object of your strength is in the one who ascended to sit on the right hand throne of the Father? And one of these old days, he's coming back again. I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know what time, but one thing I know, he's coming back. He's coming back again. Hallelujah. Praise his holy name. Is there anybody out there, anybody in here who truly know he's worthy? He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. Is there anybody in the streaming congregation, anybody in the remnant here who truly believe the object of your strength is in the one who's worthy to be praised? If you know what I'm talking about, you ought to say amen. Amen. Hey, 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 amen. 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 What is the object of your strength? And I pray that you can declare without hesitation or reservation, the object of my strength is in Jesus the Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And if you cannot say that with reservation, without reservation, without hesitation, without any doubt or fear. We invite you to believe in the one who came to bring salvation, to make a way back to God. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to heaven, no one gets to God, except they must come through the one that you say you believe is God in flesh, Savior Lord. The Bible says in Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth, believe sincerely in your heart that Jesus the Christ is Lord and God raised him from the dead, the Bible says, God's holy word, under the guidance and the power and the illumination of the Holy Spirit, you will be saved. You will be rescued from the penalty of sin. You will be rescued from the power of sin. That you will commit your life, surrender your will to his will, surrender your way to his way, and be obedient to his word. We invite you to come. If you repent and turn away from your sin, acknowledge and confess that you are a sinner who needs a Savior and a Lord, invite Jesus to come into your life, come into your heart. The Holy Spirit, by faith, will convict your heart and convert your mind and compel you to respond to Jesus the Christ, the gospel, the good news of Jesus the Christ. And so we invite you today to believe in Jesus. I want to ask if you've been convicted and you believe sincerely that you're a sinner and you need a Savior and a Lord, I want you to call this number, 706-324-2055, 706-324-2055, and tell them that I've been saved by the precious blood of Jesus the Christ. I believe he's Savior. I believe he's Lord. And I desire to become a part of his body, which is the church, which Jesus is the head. And I want to unite. I want to be planted at the 4th Street Missionary Baptist Church. Call this number, 706-324-2055. Give your name, give your number, give your contact information, and we will definitely follow up with you. And you too become a candidate for baptism, water baptism. You've already been baptized. The moment that you sincerely believe in the gospel, the preaching, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus the Christ, you were saved. You were baptized into the body of Christ. And now when the doors are open and we're back face to face, you can come and say, I publicly acknowledge, I publicly confess that I believe like you, and I desire to be baptized in the liquid grave, to be buried in Christ, and to be raised anew. As a testimony that I want to walk in the newness of life. Maybe you've been relocated here because of military reassignment. Maybe you've been relocated here because of a job relocation. Maybe you're matriculating through one of the colleges, one of the universities in Phoenix City, maybe in Russell County, maybe in Muskogee County, Columbus, Georgia, maybe in Harris County, maybe in Midland, in Fort Benning, wherever it may be. We invite you to come and to unite here at the 4th Street Missionary Baptist Church, where you can grow in the will, the way, and the word of God. Call this number, 706-324-2055, 706-324-2055, and let them know, give them your name, your number, any of the contact information that we can follow up with you. And we thank God for the moving of the Holy Spirit that will lead you back unto Christ to unite here at the 4th Street Missionary Baptist Church. Maybe you've strayed away for whatever reason. And you say, I know I have a relationship, but I'm out of fellowship. And we want to invite you to come and to enter back in fellowship, reunite here at the Fourth Street Missionary Baptist Church, where you can grow, mature. Experience the fellowship of other believers in Jesus Christ. Call this number, 706-324-2055. Let them know you desire to enter back in fellowship, to reunite with Fourth Street Missionary Baptist Church. We welcome you. We welcome all in the name of Jesus. Thank you so very much for your patience. We thank you for your prayers. And we thank you for your participation. We thank you for connecting through live streaming, Facebook Live. We thank you. We pray something has been shared. Pray something has been preached to not only encourage you, but to also convict and to challenge you, that you may grow spiritually, that you may mature the will, the way, and the word of God. We've come to the time of worship continuously as we worship through giving. And we're going to ask now that those who use Givelify, or those who can use Givelify, we ask that you would go to the 4th Street Missionary Baptist Church site. Look for the emblem, the logo, the brand, the crib, the cross, and the empty tomb. Then you know you're at the right site. And we ask that you would go ahead and give now. Bring your tithe and your offering through the platform of Givelify. We thank you so very much for your supporting. If you've chosen to bring, to drop off your tithe and your offering, you can bring it and drop it off at our Christian Education Building in the drop box. We just ask that you would practice physical distancing and wear your mask. But you can take the envelope that the church provides and you can go ahead and prepare it right now. We ask that you would place your name, your number, your address, any contact information that we can enter into the database, that we can upgrade and update our data base here at the church, that we can maintain contact, we can correspond with you. And then just check the box or the categories that you're making your contribution and prepare to drop it off during the week between 10 and 4 p.m. 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. and on Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 1 o'clock p.m. We thank you. We also want to ask those who will use the mail to mail it in. We thank you so very much for mailing it in. You can take the same envelope that's provided, provide, check your categories of contributions, place your name, your number, and your address. Please update those areas that we too can make sure that we have the correct information in our database, that we can correct whatever needs to be corrected. You can place it into a mailing envelope. Address it to the 4th Street Missionary Baptist Church, P.O. Box 1591, 1591, Columbus, Georgia, zip code 31901. Our guests are also welcome to go through Givelify to drop it off or to mail it in. We definitely appreciate your support. God bless you. God keep you is our prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you for these who continue to demonstrate their allegiance, their loyalty, their love, their trust, and their obedience. By demonstrating your generosity through them, through the tithe and offerings, bless them now. Bless their families. And we thank you for the givers, the generous givers, that you may also provide for their every need according to your riches, your generosity, and glory. Help it to continue to be used to advance your kingdom. It's in the precious and glorious name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
I want to ask that you would continue to pray for one another, continue to reach out to one another, connect with one another. We will have deep sea fishing this evening at 5 o'clock. We're in the book of 1 Samuel. If you ever want to study 1 Samuel, please join us. And then on Monday at spiritual brunch, we're in the book, concluding with the book of Mark. And on Wednesdays, we ask that you will prepare your questions, but also to receive whatever God will lead us to receive through engaging asking on Wednesday at 6 p.m. Dear gracious Father, we thank you for this worship. We thank you for your message. We pray it does not fall on stony ground or fall among thorns and thistles, that it will penetrate minds and hearts to challenge, to convict, and to convert, and to compel ones to respond, that we will be provoked to examine and to audit and to evaluate what is the object of our strength. Now, Lord, we pray that you would dismiss us from this place, but never, never from your grace, never from your presence, your provision, your power, nor your protection. It's in the precious and glorious name of Jesus, from whom all blessings flow. Let us all sing. Praise, 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 praise. Spirit, thank you, Jaqueline, for being there for our media ministry. We love you. And thank you, Willie Frazier, for the audio ministry. Thank you, Deacon Stancil. Thank you, Deacon Moore, Deacon Williams, and Deacon Clemens. We thank you, Antoine, on the organ. We thank you, Reverend Dickerson, a pulpit helper. We thank you, Christopher Coleman, on the drums, the percussions, and Sister Tandra Holyfield. We thank you so very much. God bless you. God keep you is our prayer. And Tresca Hardy, thank you so very much for blessing us through song. Power to all. May God's blessings be upon you. Walk in his strength. God bless you.